Sivaraman S. He completed his undergraduate studies from Tyagarajar College of Engineering. He pursued architecture with almost 5 years of practice and allied 3 years of professional architectural photography. He worked as an architect for Studio Kriya Architects Private Limited, which is a part of TVH Housing, Chennai. And he also worked for the Architectural Design Group, ADG, headed by A.R. Dhanasekaran, Chennai. He's also worked for many other organizations like Design Cube Architects, Carvin Design Consultants, and AIM Associates previously.
Welcome to UGC Lecture Series for Bachelor's in Architecture. This is Vernacular Architecture, AR6007, and we'll be looking at Unit 2, Approaches and Concepts, Part 1, Lecture 3. So what we'll be looking at today is the introduction to approaches. So we've talked about the factors affecting vernacular architecture, the factors that shape up vernacular architecture. Now we'll be talking about the study approaches to vernacular architecture. So we'll be looking at aesthetic approaches, archaeological approaches, anthropological, behavioral, architectural, modern. The approaches that is very important to us will be aesthetic approach, which we talk in general, the anthropological approach, the architectural approach, and of course the modern approach. The other approaches use vernacular architecture to study their particular thing, but does not specifically apply to architecture or what we need to study. So let's start. So the approaches to vernacular architecture, we'll just talk about the basic approaches that are available. Aesthetic approach relates to quality, value, etc. Anthropological approach, relationship between family and social structures. So this is an important aspect for studying vernacular architecture. Then we move on to archaeological approach, reveals indication of architectural elements and also the various artifacts or building materials or anything that is very archaeologically relevant to the present day. Behavioral approach relates to the behavioral pattern in relation to the built up structure and their personal community. Example, urban and rural community. So the behavior of the particular community of in a settlement is an important a study for us to approach. Conservationist, to evaluate the potential of traditional historical buildings for reuse. So there are various approaches to the study, things that can be learnt or derived from vernacular architecture. Differs based on what a person wants to particularly learn. Furthermore, types are developmental, to relate archaeological and organization principles and bring technology and analysis in vernacular buildings. So you, from the various things that you can learn, the principles and technology that can be adapted or reused can be an important approach study. Ecological approach focuses on habitat as a part of total environment system. Folkloristic, so we talk about the folks, the folklores that happen to be a important part of vernacular architecture. So you learn about the folk and the folklores from these things. So compares folk artifacts with the craft, skill, custom and benefits. Historical approaches examines various influencing forces using documentary records. So the various political, the racial things that happened during that particular era can be derived from vernacular architecture. So mesological relates to history, similar to the historical approach, documentation of drawings. So this is more specific physically. Spatial approaches, behavioral and anthropological organization, articulation of spaces and volumes. Structuralism, theories disclosing the functions and meanings of structures. So you can adapt or adopt the direct study of structures from vernacular architecture. And then we can also have the approach of generating transformation. So we talk about transformation of a settlement, the evolution from one form to another form. This can all be studied from approaching vernacular architecture. So we'll talk about these approaches in detail, and we'll talk about specifically that which is relevant to architecture. So first we talk about aesthetic approach. So when we look at vernacular architecture, there are so many things as we studied, the visual impacts that are a direct influence of the vernacular architecture of the people or of the region. So there are two distinct approaches, ethnographic and responsive. So to understand the aesthetic dimension in the culture of the building and the appreciation of the structure. So a structure can be a different thing, but appreciation of the structure is essentially an aesthetic approach in the vernacular aspect. aesthetic approach is the effective aspect of communication. So, when you study about vernacular architecture, the aesthetics are a direct way to communicate with what happened or with the factors that affected vernacular architecture. So, utilitarian. So, something that was useful or something that was with a purpose was also made to be very aesthetically pleasing. So, that is utilitarian, historical, religious, social relations, etc. So, there are religious aspects, there are aspects that talk about the seasons, that the aspects that talk about the traditions of a particular tribe or a set of people. So, these are directly affecting the utilitarian aesthetic aspects. Furthermore, the appearance and occupation contains aesthetic potential. So, when a particular vernacular architecture or the element has an occupation or a purpose, it can also translate to being aesthetic. So, furthermore, the building explains architectural creation, technology and form. So, initially these were just very crude forms, slowly it began to evolve. So, this was able to explain to us or give us a direct example or a study to the architectural creation that was possible through the way we built. The technology and form. So, these were all coded languages which were there in the vernacular architecture from which we can adapt and learn. Examples of that would be Gujarat. Decorations in the interiors and exteriors are often utilitarian. So, utility is an important aspect of a building or a shelter, but it being decorative is a very good example both in interiors and exteriors in case of Gujarat with respect to the Bora Muslims. So, you must have heard of the Bora Muslims. They are just people of 10,000 maybe all over the world, 10,000 number of people, but they have a very unique and distinct approach to architecture, which is not just a response to design, but also a very direct response to the community in which they were living, in which they were brought up and which they shaped up. Another example would be the English architecture, the British architecture. So, the finishes reveal use of structural materials. So, the British had a way of having the structural elements depict their aesthetic approaches. So, we've all heard of columns, which are an important part of the building, but the English had a very unique way of making the columns distinctive. There were very different types of columns, Corinthian columns, Doric columns as such, which is actually a structural element, but they have been decorated and made aesthetically appealing. So, that is an example from the British architecture. Japanese, on the other hand, have art dominating the decorative elements. So, on one side, we had community and social developments, which are a direct influence on the utilitarian and the aesthetic aspects. From the British architecture, we had them directly referring the structural aspects to an aesthetic level. Now, we have the Japanese who have art as an important and dominating factor in the decorative elements of the aesthetics of vernacular architecture. So, a comparative study of traditional reveals a rich diversity owing to culture and aesthetic dimensions. So, this is the unique Bora Muslim housing. So, if you looked at the aesthetic appealing aspects in this particular building, we'll understand a lot of things. So, these buildings have common walls, which means they wanted to live together as a community or they had families together. So, they stayed together, they stuck to each other. So, that is very directly impacting on the common wall system, and they all have very close or very systematic set of windows, which are again a direct response to the street in which they were. And now, the utilitarian aspects established, they show their aesthetic appeal in terms of colors or in the architectural carvings or in the decorative elements or the artifacts that they were present in these buildings. Okay, so that was the aesthetic approach. Now, we'll move on to the archaeological approach. This might not be very relevant to architecture, but nevertheless, we'll go through it. So, the date of the buildings, the chronological order of the development, documentation of changing architectural style over time. So, when you talk about vernacular architecture, when you take it up for study, you can understand various things from it. For example, it being the archaeology. So, the date of the buildings, the era in which it shaped and developed, the chronological order of development. So, a building usually developed as first a single dwelling unit and then it developed on to a group of houses and then further to a settlement. So, this happened over a period of time which also affected the shaping up of vernacular architecture. So that is an important aspect in the archaeological approach. So documentation of changing architectural style over time. So as much as building evolves over time in terms of material, the architectural features and the architectural elements develop over time. This is a very direct documentation of the archaeology. Excavation and recording of ruined structures to collect sufficient detail to allow for accurate reconstruction. So there have been architecture types, there have been settlement patterns which were there long before documentation ever began, but these were ruined or have been gone extinct, but these can be excavated and studied further. A big example of this would be the Mohenjo-daro and Harappa civilization and the settlement pattern that were unearthed. So archaeological approach helps study these things. Changes, evolution that occurred due to human behavior and spatial changes. So let's say there is a settlement pattern, there is a town, a particular invasion or a particular natural calamity as such either destroys or makes the vernacular architecture or the people move. So this makes the architecture change, it makes it evolve, it also makes it diverse. So these can all be approached and studied in the archaeological approaches. Okay, this image is actually a bungalow. We have a very, very different understanding of what a bungalow is today, but this is the evolution of the bungalow. So bungalows are nothing but huge mansions that were evolved during the British Raj era, especially in the Bangladesh area. So bungalow, that's where the bungalow word comes from. So this is nothing but a huge space with thatched roof. So that's all what a bungalow was. So when you go through archaeological approaches, you can derive what or where the particular building type or the architecture came from. So if one had to relate today's bungalow with a thatched roof big area, I don't think we'll be able to. So an archaeological approach is very important for such studies. Next we move on to anthropological. So anthropological is nothing but with relation to human scale or with relation to human beings or the way people behave and communicate. So prior to 1960, only documentation of different residence styles were done, which remained as artifacts of tradition and culture. So yes, there was documentation of a lot of traditional architecture and vernacular architecture buildings, but that was just the documentation of the traditional building type as such. It was preserved and was able to be applied. Only after 1960 was it found to be prominent that anthropological studies have an importance. So I have been repeating socio-cultural impacts on vernacular architecture an important thing, but that was only developed after 1960 or 1950s period, after it was established that socio-cultural reasons are an important aspect in vernacular architecture. So only documentation of different residence styles were done, which remained as artifacts of tradition and culture. So only that was done initially. Later 20th century, the approach changed towards functionalism, leading to paradigm study of social organization. So as much as we studied architecture or as much as we studied building materials or as much as we studied the techniques, social organization or social study was an important aspect. So Amos Rapoport was an important person with respect to anthropological studies which affected vernacular architecture. So if you get to study his works, you'll be able to clearly understand in case you want to pursue important researches further in the areas of vernacular architecture in general or of a particular area. So according to him, climate, ecology, material, technology and local economy determine the settlement pattern pertaining to regional level. So unlike today, where we use these factors such as climate, ecology to come up with design solution, those days these solutions constrained or restricted us, thus shaping the form of vernacular architecture. So these are two different things. So that was what he discovered and made an elaborate study of. So furthermore, about the study, factors such as climate, ecology, material, technology and local economy act as constraints rather than determinant, which acts as modifiers of form. So these aspect modifies the form, not exactly solves the form for us, but modifies it as a constraint. So built forms are closely interrelated to behavioral patterns and cultural values. So that was the crux of his study, of his conclusions. So built forms. So we would always relate built forms to climate, materials available as such, but the fact that the behavioral aspects of the people occupying these buildings were an important thing was something that he initiated. So cultural influence in the form is originated through symbolic conception. So notions of the right order of relationship within the social cosmic universe can play an active role in the building of the house. So, the influence in the form of originated through symbolic conception. So, behavioral or the social aspect becomes a symbolic or conceptual thing beyond a point and then become solutions to these architecture which has shaped up over the time. So, when you look at it, these factors very simply lay out what a vernacular architecture shapes up to be. So, an objective, a place to live. So, that is the first thing. So, that is actually a social aspect rather than anything else. Subjective, the climate and materials, etcetera. So, once a person decides that he wants to build a shelter, it becomes subjective as to what goes on next into making the building. Then come the aesthetics, the social and cultural aspect which applies to the aesthetics. So, he introduced vernacular architecture as a folk tradition. So, he looked directly at architecture or vernacular architecture as a relation to folk or folk tradition. So, he called it a direct and unself-conscious translation into physical form of a culture, its need and values, as well as the desires, dreams and passions of people. So, he made it very visible that it was a direct relation to the people. He talked about the dreams and passions of the people which directly related in the vernacular architecture. So, furthermore, he categorizes the folk tradition into two different types of architecture. One is the pre-industrial vernacular architecture and the modern post-industrial vernacular. So, pre-industrial means people were simpler, they didn't go into extensive techniques, extensive settlement patterns, they just stuck to what was available, what was necessary. Modern or post-industrial, so after the post-industrial or the industrial revolution, people chose occupations and had things to do separately. So, there was a separate person to build, there was a separate person to provide, there was a separate person to cater to food, such. So, this for vernacular architecture with respect to folk tradition differs drastically with pre-industrial and post-industrial. So, we look at pre-industrial first. Pre-industrial architecture refers to buildings built by the community and involves no specialized trades. So, trades. So, basically people and their trades did not matter. So, whether you were a woodcutter or not, you would build your own house. Whether you were a stonemason or not, you would build your own house. So, a trade or a particular occupation of the person did not matter. A direct response of the community that understands its own needs and requirements. So, a community or a set of people who understood their own needs and are handed down through verbal transfer of knowledge through generation. So, the knowledge was transferred from generation to generation verbally, not necessarily as a document or as a technique or a building form. So, the outcome of response tends to be very tradition oriented and the houses follow a uniform model. So, there isn't much variation. People just followed what was followed as a generation and as a tradition. The construction is clear and simple, adhering to rules drafted by ancestors. Now, we talk about the post-industrial vernacular architecture. So, post-industrial vernacular architecture differs considerably in the conceptions, design and construction. So, we take it to the next level. There are conceptions, there is design solutions and there is construction, which is involved in making of vernacular architecture, and it's not as simple as it was. So, the occupants of these kinds of houses provide input to the design and construction of the house. So, besides before they were just part of building the house or they just built their own houses, now they provided input to people who built their houses. So, they were part of the design and conception rather than the construction. So, individual variability is thus witnessed. So, an individual or an individual taste is slowly developed and that's how design became more prominent. So, this was the start of individual variability. The lack of flamboyant aesthetic display as they try to solve problems in the simplest possible manner. So, this is the part where it's really vernacular to the core because they didn't concentrate as much on aesthetic display as it is done in today's architecture. As much as it was an individual variability, they still answered to what was necessary or what is the problem that needs to be solved. So, they respected other members of the community and the environment. Okay, so that was the approaches to anthropological. Now, we move on to behavioral aspect. The human behavior, in particular the behavior pattern of a human, not just as a social community or as a community of people, but a behavior aspect of a particular person or a particular group of people. So, the human behavioral pattern of the community acts as a constraint or as a supportive element in defining the housing typologies. For example, in India, house typologies are huge as they adopt a joint family system. So, naturally, when a group of people stay together, the housing is bigger. So houses are grouped together in large numbers in clusters reflecting their behavioral pattern. So yeah, this again, the Bora Muslims and their Havelis were a direct impact of the huge houses because of the joint family system that was very much available in India. So now we talk about the architectural approach, which is very relevant to what we need to study and adapt. Manifestations of vernacular architecture in architectural practice over centuries are many and diverse. Experiencing them and interpreting them in modern context is the job of an architect. So what we do is we study vernacular architecture, we learn from it, and we adapt and reuse it in present day condition. So this is what we do in architecture approach. So furthermore, we can talk about architecture approach or how it can be further classified so that we can study and apply it. Architecture as pictorial or picturesque suggestion of symbolic identities. So we take symbols. So if there is an element in architecture, we don't really take up the element as such. It is not necessary to do that. We take up the symbol of what it represents, the concept in it. So we can take the concept and not necessarily the whole structure or the element. Architecture is determined by climate, nature, or function. So yes, we learn that climate, nature, and function are important aspects to architecture. So architecture is an embodiment of experience, emotional, spiritual, and some ceremonial quality. So this is where it has evolved. So architecture is not just something of a direct answer to the purpose, the utility, the climate or nature. It is also an embodiment of experience, emotions, spiritual, and ceremonial qualities. And iconic suggestions of symbolic identity. So identity was an important part of architecture in the later phases. Architecture is a tool to restore and discover the local technology. So vernacular architecture, the architectural approach of vernacular architecture helped us to make sure that we restored or discovered local techniques or local materials or local methods of architecture which we could apply today. So the pure form of architecture was without change by external influences which we could adapt. The design to recreate, restore these unadulterated forms, something neo vernacular. So we try to recreate or reuse these techniques such that they are not lost. Architecture approach methods further to categorize few aspects of buildings that are dominating for documentation and reuse. Example, plan, decoration, shape of openings, etc. So when we talk about buildings, we document it and use various forms of it in various studies of architecture and various buildings of architecture. Unlike vernacular architecture, which was just passed on from generation to generation, this allowed for a lot of documentation and reuse in various ways. So traditional materials and building methods to blend authenticity. So we tried to further push and make a blend between the traditional methods and the architectural concepts that were evolving. So creation of a local identity through architectural traces of vernacular at times served a variety of social goals. So local identity was an important aspect then in vernacular architecture. It also was studied to be found out to be an important aspect in the architectural traces of today. So an example of this is Hasan Fathi's architecture. Hasan Fathi is an architecture who was an important architect during the time of F.L. Wright and Lee Corbusier, but he did not participate in the design revolution as such. He kept to the vernacular architecture or the local architecture as such of Egypt especially. You could look into the housing that he built for Thebes. So Thebes after when they were looking for a rehab kind of life, a new way of life, Hasan Fathi built them a set of housing which not necessarily made them feel alienated or made them feel detached from their roots. He made something that was very much connected to the roots. So this is an example of how architecture was directly adapted in order to keep to the roots of the vernacular architecture. So it aimed to preserve the national identity. So the identity was an important aspect of it. So here is another simple direct approach. In Egypt again, pigeon is a part of the daily diet in many parts. So pigeon was an important source of food in Egypt, and pigeon houses or dove courts are constructed from mud brick to create an artificial mountainous topography. So a pigeon kind of housing which housed the pigeons, helped them to trap as well as use the pigeon for various aspects of their livelihood, became an important form of the architecture approach. So that image is something of a pigeon house. So furthermore, the droppings are also a valuable source of fertilizer, and the houses are so universal that they are also a part of the Egyptian national identity. So you see something of a food or a daily diet which resulted in them building such a form is actually an important part of the identity of Egypt. So that's how the architectural approach has evolved and shaped up. Now we talk about the modern approach. So we've studied architecture, we've studied anthropological, we've studied aesthetic. What is different in modern approach is what something we're going to see. So modern approach is something that constantly emphasizes on something about timelessness or timeless architecture. So when you look at a building, you are able to put a time on it or say it was from this particular era or such. But modern approach or modern architecture, which studies vernacular architecture and adapts it, looks to make architecture timeless, such that it is relevant in any part of the future or the past. So when we look at vernacular architecture, it belongs to a particular region, it belongs to a particular era. So it may or may not exist or may not adapt to present day situation, but that is the crux of vernacular architecture. So modern approach wants to go beyond this and make it timeless. So alternative to aesthetic approach is modern approach. Modern architecture aims to free from those stylistic tradition and to create a timeless version of architecture. So modern approach adopts the following: complexity of various forms. Expressions could be modern and need not be traditional material construction and technology. It could be a combination of all of this made timeless or detached from a particular time. So recreating complication of hybrid forms that occurs in spite of constraints of climate. So they tend to create hybrid forms which may or may not be a direct response of the climate, but are still able to be an answer to the solution. Materials and forms produce sensory delight and are spiritually uplifting. So as much as need and utility was an important aspect, what was important was the sensory delight or spiritual upliftment. So when you look at a building, you just don't need to go into it and do your work. You also need to be enriched emotionally. So that was something that modern approaches are seeming to want to answer regularly. So modern approach architects felt that vernacular architecture affirmed the following modern ideologies. So as much as modern approach wants to keep it timeless or wants to make it beyond the processes that have been come through, it also accepts and affirms certain factors from the vernacular architecture, such as the utilitarian use. So it affirmed the fact that a building needs to be severely utilitarian. Functional material and technology need to adapt to climate needs. So they also answer to that. Beautiful on the sculptural expression, mass and volume as a result of manipulating the plan and section to accommodate the user's need. So they made sure as much as sensory delight was necessary, it also answered to the utility and needs of the building inhabitants. So here I have two examples for you of something that is termed as timeless. This is a Ronchamp built by Le Corbusier. So if you look at it, you can't really say it is vernacular, or you can't really place a time or a particular style to it. It rises above all these to become somewhat of a timeless thing, such that it is not attached or pulled down by any root as such. This also is a building of sculptural concrete. It was built by Robert Luce, and it's called the Second Gothenium. This is actually a complete concrete sculptural. So this also rises above style, traditions, and makes sure that this is something of a timeless thing. Another thing that which further helps us to understand the modern approach is that it doesn't necessarily have to stick to architecture. It also moves on to various other levels. A direct exhibition of that would be the exhibition of Architecture Without Architects. This was done by Bernard Rudofsky. He had an exhibition of built spaces of architecture without architects. So you can get from the term that there have been buildings which are not done by architects, which still are relevant and actually pleasing to the eye. So this went beyond picturesque and conveyed the following. So the factors that it showed to us, which not necessarily have been produced by architects, are the qualities induced, human scale, great views, visual richness, features which heighten social interaction. So social interaction, visual richness was something that was done not with respect to architecture necessarily. So with that, we come to the end of this lecture. what we understand from this lecture is that we understand the various approaches to study, as we've seen, to practice a document vernacular architecture, the significance of each approach, apt to purpose of study of vernacular architecture. So, some have their specific own specific results. Some have a direct result on the study of architecture. The analysis of architecture approach and modern approach to get closer to understanding and applying lessons from vernacular architecture. So, the modern approach, the aesthetic approach, the architectural approach, how they all come together to make us understand or give better solutions to the architecture needs of today. Study of the works of Bernard Rudofsky and Amos Rappaport in understanding the role of vernacular architecture. Furthermore, some exercise which you could try is study of modern architecture examples with adaptations of vernacular architecture. So, obviously, there are a lot of buildings, as I said about Hassan Fathi. So, you could pick some examples like that which adapt from vernacular architecture and provide modern solutions. Studying the works of Lee Corbusier, F.L. Wright and Charles Courier with respect to India and their approach to design with respect to vernacular values. So, not just keeping as a traditional document, they also adapted these methods and used it in their design to better the solutions. And study of exhibitions of architecture without architects in the Museum of Moving Arts. Thank you.